Well, thank you for being here tonight. My name is Old Man Davidson. I've been on staff here at Lakeview for a little over 26 years. My wife and I first came to Lakeview in May of 1978. We have one daughter, Ashley, and four monsters, grandchildren. Can you name them? Emily, Jonathan, Anna, Ellen. And this is my wife. She's standing in the back. No, you're not standing. Stand up. No, she's short. She's short. There she is. She's short. AJ. She can play anybody basketball in here, except for AJ. Oh, man, what a group. They told me it was this kind of a group. Frank warned me. Well, we're thrilled. We really are. So excited that you're here tonight. This is not an easy thing to do, you know, come on Tuesday night and then Friday night and hopefully tomorrow morning, because we're all busy. But here's what you have decided to do. You have decided in the face of... How many of you are busy? Only four of you. Okay, that's not bad. In the face of your busyness, you've decided to listen to and obey what the Lord says. Go to the retreat. And so that, for that, we're thankful. We thank you for that. We know it's not an easy thing to set aside an evening. The only thing is, thank goodness the Saints are not playing the Seahawks tonight or something like that. No telling who would be here. I know my wife would not be here, but she enjoys her football. She is rooting for Alabama. No, that's one thing she's not doing. She's hoping Alabama will get stomped next week, correct? All right. Well, you know, how many of you don't like that? This is Louisiana. Where are y'all from? Who are you? Are you from Alabama?
Roll Tide.
Where?
Roll Tide.
Where's that? You know, she can be delivered of that. We can lay hands on her later, and maybe the Lord can cast that thing out of her. All of you stay away from Kelly. She's dangerous. This evening, what we're going to be doing is speaking about the twofold ministry of the Holy Spirit. The ministry of bringing us into or birthing us into the kingdom of God. And then tomorrow morning, the ministry of the Holy Spirit in empowering us to live as citizens of the kingdom of God. And so obviously the initial step is to become a citizen of the country. And then once you're a citizen of the country, you begin to live out that citizenship. And to live in such a way that you are declaring that the country in which you are a citizen is worthy of you being a citizen because of the way you are carrying out your duties. We all know that. And so tonight we'll be talking about the birthing ministry of the Holy Spirit. All of you know, you've heard in Alpha, Frank has talked about it for a good while. Who is the Holy Spirit? Holy Spirit, and I think probably most of you, if not all, have been raised in a church that has taught that the Christian God, the God, the true God, is not a single person God, but he is a triune God, one being of God in three persons, Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And so the Holy Spirit is one of the three divine persons in the Godhead, or in the Trinity, as we sometimes say. The Bible refers to him as the Holy Spirit. The Bible refers to him as the Spirit of God. In the New Testament, he's sometimes referred to as the Spirit of Christ. And it is the Spirit of God, the responsibility and the role of the Holy Spirit, who takes what God the Father has decreed that his people should be saved, and what the Son has made possible through his death and resurrection, that he has paid for the ability of God to forgive his people so that they could become his people. And now, after the resurrection, you remember the Holy Spirit is sent into the world on the day of Pentecost. We read that in Acts 2. And the Holy Spirit now is the person of God who is most active in the world, gathering the people of God. He is the one now who is going out into the fields of the world and collecting the harvest that Jesus has won at the cross. And so that's what he'll be doing tonight. Tonight as we speak, we are praying and hoping and believing that there are going to be several of you who are going to begin to feel. And I really want that word to be sinking into your hearts and minds. Feel. How many of you want to feel the love of your husband or wife? How many of you want to feel that? Feel the love of your mama, your daddy, your children, your grandchildren. I want that. My wife and I were at the football game the other night. One of our granddaughters is a junior cheer. What do you call it? No. Drum majorette. So we went to the game. No, it wasn't. Whatever it was. Dean is saying it wasn't a game, but whatever it was, she was out there. And my grandson and my daughter and my son-in-law came to sit with us. And when my grandson came up, he's 20 years old next month, he gave me a big kiss. Says, I love you, Papa. That's what I like. Amen? I like the feeling of love and fellowship and of relationship. And I think you do too, don't you? And so tonight as we speak, some of you are going to begin to feel the Holy Spirit's move in your heart as you hear with your mind's ear. You're going to feel and experience that working love of God in you. And you're going to experience a desire to do what he tells you to do. So I just want to let you know in the beginning, as I speak, listen with the ears to get the understanding, but listen with your heart, with your feelings. Where you at, Joan? With your feelings. Because with the mind and the heart together, God births us into the kingdom. So tonight, as we speak about the ministry of the Holy Spirit, the Bible's term is to be born again. Now, you've heard that in Alpha, to be born again. We read in 1 Peter 1:3, and I think if you have notes, hopefully I'm tracking with my notes a little bit. Sometimes I deviate, but that's okay. The Bible term for is born again, coming into the kingdom, being born again. 1 Peter 1:3, God has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. So the phrase born again was first used by Jesus. It was not first used by Billy Graham or any televangelist. They got it from Jesus. And so it's a very respectable term, although it has been abused like probably a whole lot of terminology that we used to use these words and now we can't use these words because they mean such a different thing. And so we have to be careful what we say, especially if we remember words that from years ago had different terminologies. So Jesus uses this term born again. In John chapter 3, one evening he's in the house, gets a knock on the door. Who's there? It's Nicodemus. Nicodemus is the teacher of Israel. He's a priest. And so he comes in and he asks Jesus, said, look, Jesus, I know you're from God. Because no one can do these kinds of works of miracles unless he's from God. We know you're from God. And so as he begins to say this, Jesus interrupts him and he says this in verse 3. He says, truly, truly, I say to you, unless a person is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Now, is that verse in your notes? Okay. Unless a person is born again, he what? Cannot see the kingdom of God. And Nicodemus said, how can a man be born when he's old? How can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born? Jesus answered, truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born of the water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh. That's your first birth. Physically, we're here because we've been born. Most of you, I think, can testify to that. And that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. So God wants to do a second birth in those whom he loves in order to birth them into the kingdom of God. The wind blows where it wishes and you hear the sound, but you do not know where it comes from, where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit. So what is Jesus telling us in these verses? What are these verses emphasizing? First of all, in verse 3 and in verse 7, if you have a Bible, you might make sure you look at these two verses. Jesus says this, unless someone is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God, and then you must be born again. So there is a strong emphasis in Jesus to Nicodemus, telling Nicodemus effectively, Nicodemus, you've lived all your life as a pious Jew. You have kept all the law as best you could. You've gone to all the church services. You've ministered at the altar. You've taught. You've done all this. But isn't it interesting that Jesus does not say to Nicodemus, Nicodemus, if anybody can get into heaven, you going in. No, he tells this very, very religious man, this leader in Judaism, Nicodemus, you have to be born again. You have to be born again. And so tonight, what we're going to do is to share how the Spirit causes us to be born again. And I want to do it this way, using three words that I felt the Lord give me some time ago. And the three things the Spirit does in bringing us into the kingdom. He warns us, he woos us, and he wins us. He warns us, he woos us, and he wins us. Tonight, we're praying that the Holy Spirit will warn you of the danger that you're in if you're not part of the kingdom of God. Tonight, we're praying that those whom he warns, he will then woo. And having wooed you, tonight, he will win you into his kingdom to be his forgiven, accepted, adopted children forever his, forever to be with the Lord. Father, all the words that all of us have together, Father, cannot penetrate anyone's heart. Father, that's your work by your Spirit. So, Father, we ask you to do what you said you would do. Father, that you would move by your Spirit tonight, bringing revelation, conviction, and rebirth to those whom you love, to those whom you are bringing into your kingdom. Father, move in a great way by your Spirit tonight. We ask to see new children in your kingdom. We ask you to do this for the sake of your great name, for the sake of the work of the Lord Jesus on the cross. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, he woos us. Let me read this verse to you that all of you have heard, the good news. The word gospel means good news. You've all heard John 3:16. What does it say? For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him, what? Should not perish, but should have eternal or everlasting life. Now, that's good news. That's the beginning of a three-part statement that Jesus makes. We typically stop there and don't go any further. Jesus loves you. God has sent his son to love you. That's great. But you see, if I walked around and to say, I have a bottle of pills here, would you take one free? I don't think so. You don't know what's in those. Would you take one? I have pills. How many of you would take one of these pills? Just take one. Well, you don't know who I am, what I'm doing, what the pill's all about. Why do I need the pill? Why do I need the pill? Well, I love you. I care about you. So, would you take the pill, Herb? Well, you're not going to do that. I wouldn't take a pill from someone, would you? Because I don't have any reason to take the pill. So it's great and it's okay to share with people that God has loved the world so much to send his son, but we should not stop there. We cannot stop there because that's only a small part of what the gospel is. You see, if the gospel is the good news, why is the Spirit beginning by warning us? You see, the Spirit warns us in order to get our attention. I used to teach English, high school English, in all girls high school down in Chalmette, Andrew Jackson High School, from 66 to 70. And we'd be talking about verbs and dangling participles and run-on sentences and Edgar Allan Poe, poems, you know, stuff like that, right? Oh, taking notes. Okay, Mr. Davison, all right. Onomatopoeia. You know. And there was sometimes interest, sometimes not. But then I said those words. Oh, by the way, what I'm giving you tonight or today, I told you I'm going to come get you.
Welcome.
What I'm giving you today in this little classroom is on the final exam. Oh, Mr. Davison, wait. Could you repeat? Oh, could you go over it again? We didn't hear you. Right, Bob? Come on. Write it all down. Why? Write it all down. A final exam. Final exam. Right, ladies? Final exam. You remember when y'all went to school? The thing that got your attention the most out of the teacher is what? This is going to be on the final. Why was it so important to have the final get right? Because if you don't pass the final exam, you don't get your, what, graduation certificate. And if you don't get your graduation certificate, you might not get a good job. And if you don't have a good job, you might die. Whatever. You see, it's on the final exam. And how do I know that? Because you see, when Jesus starts this wonderful, wonderful verse, look how it starts. Verily, verily, I say unto you. Some of your translations may say, amen, amen, I say unto you. There are two or three different ways of translating. It's a Hebrew part of speech, or idiomatic part of speech. It means, what I'm going to tell you is so important that you have to have it. This is on the final exam. In fact, being born again is so important. It's not only on the final exam. I want you to get this tonight. Really, I want you to get this. Being born again is not only God's final exam when you stand before him. It's not only on it. It is the final exam. He's not going to ask you, were you Methodist, Baptist, Catholic? He's not going to ask you your race. He's not going to ask you what gender. He's not going to ask you how much money you put in the plates. He's not going to ask you how you try to do this and that. That's not on the final exam. That may be important and good. We're not dismissing those things, right, Steve? But the final exam is that which gets us into the presence of God's kingdom forever. And so this issue of being born again is the most important issue, the most important bit of news that any of us will ever hear. You are not going to hear anything more important in your life if you are not part of the kingdom of God, except for this. To be in the kingdom of God, you must be born again. It doesn't matter whether Hillary is elected or whether Trump is elected. It doesn't matter whether the stock market goes up or down, whether Russia does. It doesn't. None of that effectively matters, because in 100 years from now, I dare say that most of us will not be living on this earth. We will be gone. 100 years, 50 years, 25 years from us now, a whole lot of us won't be here. And if I'm here, think how cranky I'll be then. The final exam is coming. Every day you wake up, it's a day closer to the final exam. How do you pass? You must have on your soul written, born again. If it's not there, there's no quick negotiation. There's no quick, well, let me go back and do something. There's no quick, well, let me pay a little bit more over here. You see, the Spirit is like the teacher who warns the students why it's important to listen to the lesson. So now, let's listen to what Jesus says in the rest of the commentary. He starts off verse 16, God so loved the world. Then in verse 17, what does he say? For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world. Say what? To condemn the world. What do you mean condemn? I thought Jesus loves everybody. But that the world through him might be saved. Saved from what? Condemnation. For God didn't send his Son into the world to condemn us. Condemning. But to save us from the condemnation. You see, now we're beginning to get into the reason why it's so important to understand how to be born again. Verse 18, listen to 18 carefully. And if you have a Bible, you may want to underline a couple of these words. The word love in verse 16, the word condemn and save in verse 17, and then in verse 18, whoever believes in Jesus, in him, is not condemned. Okay, there you go again, is not condemned. But whoever does not believe, notice it didn't say, didn't go to church, didn't pay the tithes, whoever does not believe, who is not born again, he's talking about being born again, remember, is condemned already because he has not believed in the name of the only Son of God. What is this condemnation? What is the problem in our life? The problem in our life is that we are sinners. We have sinned. And that the sin we have committed has the most grave circumstance, or consequence rather. It has the most grave consequence of anything else. Look down at verse 36. Again, he's still talking about being born again. We're talking about the context of being born again. I love you. I have not come to condemn you, but to save you. If you believe in me, you're not condemned. If you don't believe in me, you are condemned. And then let's look at verse 36 when he explains to us what that condemnation is. Well, what is the condemnation? What is the problem with being condemned? Verse 36, whoever believes in the Son has eternal life, has God's life, will be in the kingdom of God. Whoever does not obey the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abides or remains on him. Remains. What does that mean? That means for those who are not receiving Jesus as the only one who has forgiven, paid for our sin, as the only payment for our debt, for those who have not received, Jesus says in the same breath that I love you, that if you do not receive me and trust me and submit to me and walk with me, if you do not do that, or I don't believe that, or I think it's another day, or I don't understand, whatever. He says, the wrath of God abides. Abide means settled, continuing life of a wrath of God forever and ever and ever. Never ending, never ending, never ending. Once our hearts stop beating, the door of hope closes and locks, and we are hopeful for all of you here tonight that when the heartbeat in your life stops, I will be doing two funerals in the next couple of weeks, that you will be in heaven with God. And tonight is the night that for some of you, the Holy Spirit is saying, I'm bringing you in tonight. Please walk with me. See, this is the reason for the warning. The consequence of our sin is far worse than just not being with God or not having a happy life here or not being blessed. The consequences of our sin are eternally the worst thing that could ever happen to anyone, and the worst thing that will ever happen to anyone. What's the reason? Why is God so upset? Verse 18, Romans 1:18. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against ungodliness and unrighteousness of men. So because of our sin, because of our rebellion against the Lord, because of that, God has placed us in the realm of condemnation. And the wrath of God sits on every single person in this world. And the only way that wrath is removed is it is removed at the cross for those who are born again. Do we get that? The only way the eternal condemning wrath of God is removed, it is removed at the cross for those who are born again. At the cross, Jesus becomes the doorway for all of his people to enter the kingdom of God through being born again by the Spirit. So now, we've heard the warnings. And this is a loving warning. You know, some people would say, oh, you shouldn't preach hell. Shouldn't do that. Oh, really? Well, because God is love. Oh, really? So we shouldn't warn? No, really. So your little five-year-old is playing out on the street. You shouldn't warn your little five-year-old, don't run out into the traffic. Is that what you're telling me? Oh, no, I wouldn't do it. Why are you going to yell, Johnny? Why are you going to do that when you see your child go near the curb? I was watching the other day, a little daddy was walking his two little kids and down the avenue, and when they got to the corner, you know, they were getting to the corner, and the daddy didn't, you know, he yelled at him, stop, but he wasn't sure, and he was dashing all he could to grab his kids. They did stop, but this guy was throwing himself on his kid. Why? Why worry about it? Why do we warn? Why do you warn those whom you love? Because you love them. Amen? God is a good God. We're on the wrong track until we're born again. We're going the wrong way. And God announces from heaven, through the giving of his Son, and through the giving now of the Holy Spirit, there is danger out there. It's eternal danger. And he says, don't be condemned. Call upon the name of the Lord Jesus to escape this condemnation. He does it because he loves us. Remember, John 3:16, 17, and 18, go together. Don't just read the one verse that, oh, we love that verse. Read all three, because all three present the full picture of what the love of God is all about for us. So now, having warned us, we're ready to be wooed. I'm ready to listen now. You're going to die if you don't take this pill. Oh, well, let me hear about the pill. Do you understand that? You go to the doctor and he says you have a terminal disease and you're going to die in a month. He warns you. Once he warns you, then he takes out a little box of pills. And he says, in these pills is the ability to absolutely cure you of this thing that's going to kill you in a month. Sissy, now would you be interested? Yes. You okay? You're going to be interested. How many of you will still not be interested? You're going to die in a month. And here's a little box of pills that if you take them, you're guaranteed you won't die. All of a sudden, does the doctor have our attention? You see, Dr. Holy Spirit gives us the reason why we should pay attention. And now he's ready to tell us why and how these pills can do their work of healing. He's going to explain that. He's going to woo us. 1 Thessalonians 1:10 says this about the good news of the gospel. Here's the good news of the gospel in encapsulated form, I believe. Jesus delivers us from the wrath to come. 1 Thessalonians 1:10. Jesus delivers us from the wrath to come. Now, did it say Frank Loria? Did it say Keith Collins? Did it say old man Davidson? It didn't say anybody's name that you know. Only one name. God has only given one man. God has only given one man. One man to save us from the wrath to come. He didn't give us a system. He didn't give us a way of life. He didn't give us certain rules and regulations to obey in order to be born again, in order to be in the kingdom. He gave us a man, a person, who in some way would do something, which we'll say in a moment, that God accepted for the forgiveness of our sins so that we could become the children of God, having been forgiven because of the work of Christ. So what does 1 Thessalonians 1:10 say? Jesus does what? Does what? What does it say there? Delivers us. Does it say he hopes to deliver us? Maybe he can deliver us. I hope to God he will deliver us. What does it say? He delivers us from the wrath of God. Who are the us? Those who have been born again. Are you getting this? Do you see the context here? How does he do it? How does Jesus do this? Well, there's many verses that would describe it, but there's a wonderful verse in 1 John 1:7. And the Apostle John says, the blood of Jesus, God's Son, cleanses us from all sin. May I repeat that? 1 John 1:7. I don't know, it may be in your notes, I'm not sure. The blood of Jesus, God's Son, cleanses us from how much? I'm sorry, I can't hear well. All sin. How much is all? How much is all? Anybody know how much all is? What's left out of all? What's included in all? Is there any sin when God tells you this kind of truth through his apostle? The Holy Spirit isn't mincing words, and he's not talking hyperbolically. Well, I don't really mean all, but I'm going to say all, you know what I mean? Eat all your peas. Why were there four left? You ate them all? Yes, I ate them all. Okay, fine. No, you know, that's not what he's saying. When the Son of God, by the Holy Spirit, when the Holy Spirit through this apostle says, Jesus, God's Son, cleanses us from all sin, how much is all there, Miguel? How do you say in Spanish, all? Todos. Todos? Todos? It's todos. Todos. Whatever it is. It says, no telling what I really said, is there? Those of you who speak Spanish, if I called you something, it's not my fault. It's Miguel made me say that. Now listen to me carefully. How much sin do you believe that you have committed since you were born? Should I pick on anybody? What'd you say? A lot. How old are you? 15. Think how much more I have at 73. Seriously. How much sin have you committed since you were born? Cliff? It took your breath away, didn't it? Seriously. No, really. How much sin? Incalculable, because we don't even know what we're doing half the time when we're sinning. We're not aware of half the sin, I think. We're only made aware, I think, of a very small portion, like the iceberg. 10% is on the top. Look at what's underneath. How much sin and how much of it does Jesus pay for at the cross? How much, Bertus? Now, what does that mean? Get it tonight. Colossians 1:2-13, having been forgiven all trespasses. You see, when it comes to dealing with the forgiveness of sin, the Holy Spirit emphasizes this word, what? All. Never says almost, never says most, never says anything except one word, what? All sin. That means this, that from the moment I was conceived in October, the moment I was born, let's say, in October 28, 1943, till the day I die, wherever that will be, over here, every sin, may I repeat that? Every sin is gathered up into the arms of this great, great eternal man. And he takes the full weight of all of my sin from the very beginning heartbeat to the very last heartbeat. And he gathers it to himself. And then not only for me, but for all his people, millions. And all of this sin he carries to the cross. And all of that sin, not even one being missed. Not even one being missed. All of it is placed on the shoulders of this Shechem, this great God of ours, this God-man. And at the end of the 6 hours, Jesus gathers up his breath in John 19:30, and he says, "Tetelestai," which in the Greek means what? It is paid for, finished. All of it is finished. All of it forgiven. All of it. All of it. And for everyone who is born again, the reason we can be born again is because when the Father causes Jesus to pay the price, the Father lays on Jesus the iniquity of us all, and he crushes Jesus with the wrath that we deserved. Jesus is punished in our place as if he had sinned, as if he had sinned. And when he died, God accepted that as the full payment for our sin. How do I know that? Because Jesus rose from the dead, vindicating that what he did was accepted forever as a full, final, and forever payment of every sin of every one of his people. Can you say amen? This is what being born means, to have all of your sin being transferred to someone else so that we no longer have to pay the payment. Do you realize that one sin by one man, one time, just one sin by one man, just one time, brought death into the world and the entire cosmos collapsed? Just one sin. How many have I committed? How many offenses toward this holy, righteous, great God have I committed against him in thought and word and deed constantly through things I do and things I don't even know I'm doing because I'm not trusting him in so many areas. I'm not even aware of it half the time. And yet all of that is placed on his son. And when he dies, the Bible says, sin was condemned or put to death as to its penalty and guilt in my life and in the life of everyone who was born into the kingdom of God. I therefore, because of that, the Bible says, I am justified. You're justified. God says, when he looks at you who have been born again, you are not any more guilty of sin. I can look now at all my people and declare that you are no longer guilty of sin. Why? I have sinned, but why am I no longer guilty? Because Jesus has paid my price for my sin. Amen? That's good news. That's good news. That's the content of this pill that the doctor is saying, Raphael, tonight take this pill and live. Don't go look for other pills. Don't go to another pharmacy. Don't go to these quacks, these liars, these deceivers. Come to Jesus. He is, if you would allow me to say so, the pill. He is the pill. of eternal life. He is the pill of eternal life. Tonight, as we speak this way, what are you feeling on the inside of it? I want you to feel, if you've not been born again, I want you to feel the weight and the seriousness of your situation, your sin that is under the condemnation and the wrath of God. And you're not going to get out of this. There's no hope unless you take this pill of Christ. There's no hope. You say, I'll take a chance. There ain't no chance. It's 100% against you. If you feel that, I want you to also feel the love of this God who would pay such a price to win your hearts. There's a lady who has not been in this church for years because of an illness, but her name is Evelyn Mormon. And Evelyn and Bo were members of the church for many years. And Bo was taken into the hospital dying of cancer. So I was visiting Evelyn. And Bo, by that time, has been pretty well unconscious. They'd been giving him the morphine, at the end. I was sitting at Ochsner Hospital with her and talking to her. I said, Evelyn, tell me a little bit about you, how you and Bo got together. She said, well, years ago, in the 30s, I knew Bo. But I didn't like him. I knew him, but I didn't like him. I said, well, what happened? Well, he had a car, and I wanted to ride someplace. You see, he had the car. And in the 30s, look, I grew up in the 50s, and very few people had cars. He had a car, Betty. So she wanted to go places, so she went places with Bo because he had a car. So, she went with him. Oh, okay, Bo. But something happened. You see, because Bo had his eye on Evelyn. You see, God has his eye on you. His eye's on you. Bo had his eye on Evelyn. He was interested in her. So they went together here and there. And she said, he began to give me things and be nice to me. And slowly, what was Bo Mormon doing? He was wooing Evelyn's affections, right? He was saying, come on, Evelyn, I love you. And let me show you how I love you. And slowly, her heart was beginning to be melted by the love of this man for her. He began to woo her with his goodness, his kindness, his gifts, the way they related to one another. They were married over 60 years. He wooed her to himself. You see, tonight, God is wooing you who are not part of the kingdom. There may be some in here tonight that you've never been born again. You've never trusted Jesus. You've been coming to Alpha, or maybe there's a first time here tonight, whatever. And you've realized, the Bible says every single one of us have sinned, and because of that, every one of us is under the condemnation of the wrath of God. John 3:18, every one of us. But for those who are won and wooed by God, we're the ones whom God is bringing into the kingdom. Is God doing that to you tonight? Do you feel that drawing up? I want to be in heaven. I want to be forgiven. I don't want to live the same way anymore. I want to have my life to be with God. This is what I want. I no longer want the way I've been living. I'm afraid of standing before God one day without Christ. And you should be. I want to be secure to know what's going to happen. Well, as the Holy Spirit has warned us and is wooing us, tonight, I'm praying he will win some of us, win some of you. Remember Evelyn and Beau? What happened? He won her affections. He drew her into his own life. How? By his love. And this is what God has done in us, in Christ. Think of your sin. Think of the absolute certainty that you will suffer the wrath of God forever, except you're born again. And that being born again is not anything that you have to do as far as your merit or your work. It's taking this pill, this person, this ministry, this victory, this payment that Jesus has offered and has given at the cross. 1 Thessalonians 1:10, Jesus delivers us from the wrath to come. Is this the kind of Savior you can trust? So when it finally came ready, when Beau was ready to pop the question, Charlie, I asked her. I mean, I knew they were married, but you know, I wanted to know, did he take one question, two? And Tommy said, she said, when he asked me the first time, I said, what? Yes. The question that Beau gave to Evelyn, the motive behind all of his wooing, the goal that he had in wooing her, was one goal. Why did he do this? What was on his mind? Why did he spend so much time with her doing nice things, taking her places, giving her gifts? What was his motive? He wanted what? Say what? And he wanted to marry her. He had one goal in mind, to marry her. To marry her. So he says, Evelyn, will you marry me? Suppose Evelyn would have said to Beau, well, Beau, I'll come clean your house every day. Well, I mean, Mike, that's nice, huh? But that's not like being married, is it? I can get a housekeeper anywhere. Will you marry me, Beau? Well, I'll come cut your grass. I already have a gardener. Well, Evelyn, will you marry me? Well, Beau, we've lived next door to one another and have been childhood friends all these years. We're the best pals. That's not enough, is it, Sid? To have Amy as a friend for all those years, is it? Is it different having married your friend than being a friend? All the difference in the world. He and Amy were friends for years, and all of a sudden the Holy Spirit woke him up. I remember that day. Oh, kind of like all over. Oh, I need to marry her. Isn't that right?
That's right.
Remember, I was there. Remember that? We were talking about it in my office. Oh. But did friendship make you married? No. You didn't. You weren't married until you were married. What was the only answer that was acceptable to Beau? Maybe, wait, or yes?
Yes.
Yes. All of his attention and energy and passion was for one answer. Yes. See, tonight, God has warned you. Unless a person is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Verily I say unto you, you must be born again. It's not an issue of what you do or what you didn't do, or where you go, where you raise, or how you, what church and all. It is only one issue. Are you aware of the danger of the condemnation of God's wrath upon you because of your sin? And have you and are you experiencing the wooing love of God to draw you out of that condemnation, out of that pit, out of that guilt, out of all of that killingness into the arms of a loving, saving, eternal God who has paid the price in his own Son? Can you depend upon Jesus Is this the man you can trust with your life? If your heart is saying yes, I can trust him and I want to trust him and I need to trust him and I will trust him. Friends, if you don't, what are you going to do? If you don't, where are you going to go? To whom will you go? If you don't, who else or what else is out there? As every day is a day closer to the day you stand before this Almighty God Himself. Entrance into His kingdom being on the basis of one thing. Have you received Christ? Because you're born again by receiving Christ. You're born again by trusting Him. You're born again by saying, yes, yes. Don't try to figure it out with the analytical aspects of your own mind. It won't work. Hear the basics of the gospel which you've heard tonight. And listen to your heart's desire. Because God is placing in the heart of some of you, yes, tonight. I've been to Alpha and I've been listening, but tonight. Or I've not been here before, but tonight. There's something different about tonight. Tonight. That's the Holy Spirit saying, son, daughter, tonight. I want you to respond yes. The Bible tells us in Romans 10 that whoever calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. Saved from what? The wrath to come. It's an assured wrath unless you're saved from it. Calling upon the Lord, say yes. Evelyn, you see, in that context, called upon Bo. She said yes. He called her, and her response to his response was a yes. God calls us, and our response to his call is what? Yes. That's how we're born again. So tonight, we're going to pray. We're going to spend a few minutes in prayer. We're not going to be in a hurry. We'll get dessert in a few minutes. But this is a very, very sober and serious moment. Because tonight, at this moment, is encapsulating what God has been saying to you since 7:10. It all comes down to this. Are you born again? If you are, you know it. I'm not quite sure. If you're born again, you know it. If you're not sure, you need to make sure. Are you born again? Secondly, do you need to be? Yes, you see the need. That's obvious. So the question is what? Do you want to be? Will you decide tonight to cooperate with, to agree with, not to get God to do something, but to agree with what He is already doing inside of you as He has been ministering and fooling with your feelings, if you would, stirring you up tonight to say yes. What we're going to do is pray. And there are going to be some who will say yes. This happens at every beta. I'm sorry, Alpha. Happens at every Alpha. Frank and Annette and a couple will be up here waiting. If you feel God saying on your heart, you want to say yes tonight, just come on up here. They're going to go into just another room and just pray. That's all. You've been with us all these times. I think you can trust us by now. We're not going to do anything strange. Listening to me was the strangest thing you've done. And they'll be up here. But as I'm giving an invitation, I want you to get this, and you're going to feel it. There's going to be a resistance to what you want to do. Well, I don't think so. I better not. I don't know about that. I'm embarrassed. All of that is the attempt of God's enemy, Satan, to keep you in your chair. Don't let him. I came up one day. Frank came up one day. Wayne surrendered one day. Steve surrendered one day. AJ just surrendered one day. John surrendered one day. Some of you were here tonight having surrendered at an Alpha retreat in the past, and here you're leading. So it's a good thing, because this is a family here. And this is a time of loving, rejoicing together. So let's bow your heads, please. And just listen to me as I speak, but more than that, listen to the Holy Spirit. As I've spoken tonight, has God been speaking to you and ministering to you and say, tonight, I want you to come forth. I want to bring you out of the grave as I did Lazarus. I want you to say yes to Jesus tonight. So tonight, as you're sitting at your table, as you feel the leading of the Holy Spirit, just get up tonight and come on down and join Frank and Annette up in the front. There'll be some of you. We'll wait several minutes. We'll just wait. Tonight is your night. The Holy Spirit has been speaking to you. You know He has. You felt Him. You have felt that feeling in your stomach about the condemnation of your sin, the fear, the anxiety of spending an eternity in the condemning wrath of God. Eternity. Knowing that the only way to escape that and to be saved is to say yes to this man who has paid the full price at the cross for you. It will cost you only your damnation. That's all you're going to pay, your damnation. He has taken it, and He wants to give you eternal life in the place of eternal death. Will you say yes tonight? Will there be others who will come forward just tonight to say yes? Give you several minutes. If you're struggling there, if you feel, oh, I shouldn't, or whatever, that means you should. Well, I don't know whether there's that means yes. That means the devil is struggling against you because the Holy Spirit is saying yes to you. The Holy Spirit wants you to come down. He wants you to be ministered to. He wants to save you. Anyone else? Or the others who will come and join? John, anyone else? Thank you. Tonight's your night. Tonight can be your birthday as it is my birthday in the natural. It can be your spiritual birthday, October 28, 2016. I was born again. I'm now a child of God. I'm forgiven. I'm going to heaven. My name is written in the book of life. I'm going to heaven. I'm born again. Tonight can be your night. Don't let the devil fool you. Don't let him deceive you. Don't let him keep you back. Get up. Come on down. Join these in prayer tonight to surrender your heart and to know that you're a child of God forever. Come down. Come down. Many have in this room. Many. Most of the people in this room have done this. It's okay. It's the greatest decision you'll ever make. You don't have a greater decision, no greater joy than tonight to be born again. I'm so glad it's not because I'm a member of a certain church, because I could have missed the church. I'm so glad it's not because I've done so many good deeds, because maybe I didn't do enough. I'm so glad it's not because of a particular race, because I may not be the right race or gender. I might not be the right gender. I'm so glad that Jesus paid the full price at Calvary to forgive the full weight of my sin. His full payment for my full sin. Tonight, say yes. Anyone else tonight wants to come down? Anyone else? Before we close and allow these to go back and pray. Anyone else tonight? You come down tonight. We've had people who have been members of the church for years and didn't realize they weren't saved. It's okay. It's a good thing to come down and to admit that, to get going in the new life of heaven. Come on down. There are men who are preachers who haven't been saved. There are preachers who haven't been saved. Not in this room, but I know some. And if they were in this room, I'd be saying to them, come down. Come down tonight. Come down. Anyone else? Join this growing company of those who are going to be redeemed by the blood of the Lamb, who are going to leave tonight as new people, new, relieved of the guilt, of the weight, having a new life, new hope, new joy. Come down tonight. This is God celebrating you, rejoicing. There's a party in heaven. Jesus says the angels rejoice over one who is saved. And there's a party going off in heaven because the angels are saying God is growing his number of children. More children are coming in. More children are being birthed into the kingdom. Tonight is your night. Anyone else before I end? Anyone else before I end tonight? Someone else. I'll give you one more moment. One more moment. Don't leave tonight and say, oh, I wish I had. Don't do that. If that's what you're thinking, tonight is a night for you. Anyone else before I close? Anyone else? Okay, Frank, y'all can go in the other room. As they go into the other room, they're going to pray, and they'll be back, and we'll get dessert. But before we do that, what we usually do is just to give you an opportunity of maybe asking a question or two. There was some confusion, some difficulty, something you wanted to be answered, whatever it is. We're not restricting you to any particular kind of question, although I cannot tell you who's going to win the election, so I can't do that. I would, but I can't, no. But any questions at all that you'd like to ask tonight? Yes, sir. And yes, speak up. Remember, I don't hear that well, even with hearing aids.
If I believe, and I do, that Jesus died for my sins, a complete wipe away, why do we persist with the Catholics, persist with this thing called purgatory?
Okay. Purgatory is part of the Catholic system of penance that was developed several hundred years after the first century. And it was developed with the thought, mistakenly, that all of our sins are not forgiven at the cross. It's a whole issue of the way they see justification infused and imputed. So you're going to have to give me a little leeway here not to go into all of that detail and background. Sufficient to say, Catholic theology teaches that when you're christened, I think most of us had water put on us at some time or another when we were kids. Is that right? When you're christened, that's the work of forgiving you or washing away your original sin. Remember? Then after that, you begin to grow, you begin to live, and then you have your day of confirmation, etc., and we continue on. And that the sins that we are committed or committing have to be dealt with through the penance, through the obligations, through, you know, the various forms of what the priest would tell us to do and so on. And so we're moving along in life. When we get to the end of life, not all of our sins have been atoned for. Not all of our sins have been forgiven because we've been leaving out some, or we've forgotten to confess it or whatever. So we wind up at the end of our life still having sins not forgiven. And so Catholic theology teaches that purgatory is that place and that time during which God, in some way, if you would, burns off the sin of those people. And once that happens, as they are burned off, as each person's sin is burned away, then that person is taken into heaven. The Bible says this: it is given unto man once to die, then the judgment. There is not one word in there that even hints at such a thing that there may be a second chance after death. There is no such thing as purgatory. You are either forgiven completely or you're unforgiven completely. Huh. You're either forgiven what? Completely or what? Unforgiving how much? Completely. There's no middle ground. It's either one absolutely or the other absolutely. So that's it, but it has to do with a bigger issue of justification and so on. But is that all right?
Can I quote you tomorrow when I go to confession?
You can quote me and name me and do everything else you want.
Thank you.
You see, confession to a priest in and of itself is not a bad nor an immoral or a wrong thing, because we are to confess our sins one to another. So we don't have a problem with that. The problem is God, in our understanding of the word, has not given any man on earth the ability to remit sin. Only Jesus has that, and he has remitted or forgiven all of our sin at the cross. All of it. When Jesus in Matthew says to Peter, "Thou art Peter, and upon this rock," when he says that, he uses two different genders for that word Petros, Petra and Petros. One is masculine, one is feminine. So he says to Peter, "You are the pebble. You are the pebble." That means a little bitty rock. But upon this rock, this great rock, it's a different gender. It means a massive rock. I will build my church. And then he says, "I will give to you, you know, you men, you Peter and you guys, I will give to you the keys of the kingdom of heaven." He did not say the keys to the kingdom, because in Revelation he says, "I hold the keys to the kingdom." But he says, "I will give you the keys of the kingdom." And what are the keys of the kingdom? The gospel. Tonight I have been sharing what? The keys, the unopening of the doors to heaven. That's what that means. But it's again been taken. And even the Greek is you know, using two different words here for rock. Great rock, a little bitty rock. But you don't hear much about that. Anything else? And you may share that if you like. Any other questions? I think this is the first time we've only had one question. I almost can't breathe. Well, why don't we do this quietly, because I know they're praying in there. Let's take a potty break. Well, you know, that happens. And for some of you who are not normal, the rest of us need something. And come on back in here. Don't run away, because we do have desserts. Thank you so much.